Hi, everybody, and welcome to our Exploring English Shakespeare Facebook and YouTube Live. I'm joined by Genny. Hello, Genny.
Hello, Neil. Hello, everybody.
Jenny's the lead educator on our Future Learn course, which is a free online course that we run that looks at lots of Shakespeare plays and lots about life and history and so on. We'll talk about that a little more later, and the link for it will be in the comments. But today we're here to talk about Shakespeare, of course, and learning English and how the two go together and how, well, Jenny can tell us a little bit more about this. Tell us a little bit more about the course and tell us about how Shakespeare can maybe help, you know, how Shakespeare can be involved in learning English, I guess.
Okay, well, Exploring English Shakespeare is, as Neil has said, a free six-week course, which is a wonderful introduction to Shakespeare, his life, his times, and in the course we look at five of Shakespeare's plays as well. Some of his best known plays, such as Romeo and Juliet, Macbeth, Hamlet, The Tempest, and Much Ado About Nothing. Oh, I thought I was going to miss one out there, but we got them all. And there's loads of excellent video resources on this course. You learn all about, you know, the not just what happens in the plays, but there's lots of opportunities to discuss the themes in the plays as well. And a lot of the, you know, the language, Shakespeare's language, and language that has Shakespeare invented and that we still use today, which is always a highlight for many of the learners on the course. And when we're talking about learning English, often when learners on the course introduce themselves, they talk about how, you know, they love literature and they want to develop their English whilst, you know, learning about this incredibly well-known writer. And you know, enjoying some of the best stories ever told. So it's a wonderful way to immerse yourself in this culture while improving your English as well and joining in discussions with other like-minded people.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk a lot more about that today, exactly about how, you know, the real nuts and bolts, how we can really do that. All the resources that we've got, and there are so many great resources that can make this really enjoyable. I've just been popping up. We've got people joining us from all over. You've seen already. I've just been popping up some of the countries that we've had so far, from Myanmar, Vietnam, Congo, Morocco, and Iraq, lots more. Okay, great. So anyone who's watching, just say hello and let us know where you're watching us from. I think I'd like to maybe start by asking a question to the people in the audience, and maybe the question that I'd like to ask is if the, let me just actually put this in here. Sorry for writing it just now. I'd like to just know from the people watching, a simple question: have you ever read or watched a Shakespeare play? Okay, so for everyone watching, just while we're getting started, just tell us, you know, if you had to read some at school, if you've been to the theatre, if you've watched a movie like the famous Leonardo DiCaprio, Romeo and Juliet, and things like that. Just tell us in the comments about that. Okay, lots more people. Oh, lots of comments coming in from all over now. Serbia, Pakistan, Iran, Algeria, Ireland, Philippines. Okay, so we have a very global audience watching, so that's great. So Argentina, Serbia. Okay, so as I say, so everyone watching, just tell us if you've ever watched a Shakespeare play or read a Shakespeare play, and, you know, which ones. And if you liked them or didn't like them, anything like that. Okay, we've got some answers coming in already to that. Amani starting with the first answer in a negative, which is no, I didn't. Okay, good. So our hope today is that after we finish, you'll be interested enough to go off and maybe try having a look at some of the resources that we mentioned. Okay, here's one. I unfortunately, I can't read Arabic, so I can't read the name. but saying Hamlet and the Merchant of Venice added to me many benefits. Maybe that's the name there, Lily, Libya, okay, or something, okay. And here, of course, popular choice, Romeo and Juliet. Like you mentioned, you know, I guess, what are the top? What do you think the most popular Shakespeare plays are over the whole world, Jenny?
Well, I would say probably Romeo and Juliet would be one of the most popular, but I think I've also heard A Midsummer Night's Dream is one of the most popular plays around mm-hmm. the world. And I want to say Hamlet as well, because everybody's yeah. heard Hamlet and the famous line, to be or not to be.
Yeah. So we've got lots of people here who have, obviously. Amin did during university. And a question from Kelly, who's saying, have you watched the recent, it just came out, what, this year, the Denzel Washington Macbeth? Have you watched that yet, Jenny?
Not yet. It's on no. my to-watch list.
I feel
what
so
about you?
Because I really want to watch it. Well, I you know, and I should have watched it by now. I just haven't got around to it. Apparently, it's fantastic. Kelly, you've watched it, I guess, from your question. Can you tell us about it? Tell us if you thought it was good, if you enjoyed it. Okay. And yeah, I think we're getting a lot of votes for Romeo and Juliet here. Aki has read the plays of Shakespeare. Okay. So we've got quite a few watched. We're 50-50, I would say, about watched and read so far. Okay. Right. So we've got lots to talk about today. So let's get down to the questions that we're going to be looking at. And the first question comes from Ben, who says, I'm a teacher. How can I make Shakespeare more interesting for students? That's a good question, isn't it? It can be a challenge.
Yeah, it is a challenge. And it's such an important question, because I think that first encounter that you have with Shakespeare is a really important one. And there's so many people I've met who've on the course that we were speaking about at the beginning, who've said, oh, you know, my first encounter with Shakespeare was not good. It was really boring the way our teacher taught it. Luckily, these people weren't put off for life, and they've come back and you know, gone onto the course and become quite enthusiastic about Shakespeare. But yes, we want to get our learners enthusiastic about Shakespeare from the very beginning. And there are, luckily, with the internet, we have so many resources and approaches that we can do this. So I could talk about, how long have I got to talk about this? I could talk about this for hours,
I think,
Neil.
Such, because I don't, you know, this question is from Ben as a teacher, but it's not only for teachers. I mean, the question is, you know, if you're a student, if you're a learner as well, and you're looking at Shakespeare and thinking, ah, it's too difficult, or it's too boring, or it's got nothing to do with my life, then, you know, that would be the same question, is how can we kind of, you know, make it, are there ways to get into Shakespeare for anyone?
Well, I think the first thing is to find your own way in, you know, so to think about what you're interested in, or if you're a teacher, to find out what your students are interested in. And you can very easily find like synopsis, like little paragraphs telling you what the different plays are about. So you can look around and find something that's interesting for you. For example, if you're teaching a class of teenagers, then Romeo and Juliet might be an obvious choice. There's been so many amazing cinematic adaptations of Shakespeare. You know, an option could be just to even watch or show your students some different trailers for some different Shakespeare films, and get them to talk about the ones that they might be interested in. Then with a class, I'd say again, it's about finding a way in. So you could think about some of the themes in the Shakespeare play that you're going to look at. So for example, in Romeo and Juliet, I suppose one of the main themes is, you know, disobeying parents and teenagers, and the relationships between them, and to what extent should you obey your parents, even if you think you know what's right for you. And, you know, there's so many resources online for this. We'll be talking about some really great lesson resources in a little while, talking about some of the questions that are arising out of this with your students, just getting them involved in the themes. And then I think as well, you know, when you're finally coming down to whether you're just an individual interested in Shakespeare or you're working with a class, it can be very daunting just to, you know, get your play, you know, your copy of the play in book format and start reading through it.
Yeah.
For many reasons, but I suppose mainly, you know, the Shakespearean language might initially seem quite challenging for yourself or for your students. Luckily, you don't really have to take this approach anymore. Mm-hmm. There's a number of ways you can approach Shakespeare plays, whether it's by watching a film adaptation. It doesn't even need to be a full-length film. The British Council has some excellent short films which get across the main points of the story and the main themes of the story. So you can take that approach. You can watch a shortened film. You can also, and we'll be speaking about this later on today as well, there are some excellent resources like No Sweat Shakespeare, which provide contemporary translations of the play. So you can read Shakespeare plays, but not have to worry so much about the language, the these and the thous and so on, which might get in the way of your enjoyment. So reading contemporary translations is also a really good idea. And just as well, for teachers as well, there's also a number of really excellent lesson plans on the British Council. So you can, you know, you off the peg lesson plans for a whole range of plays and for different levels of learners as well. So you don't need to like have this play and think, what am I going to do? How am I going to teach this play? You don't even need to focus on the whole play. You can take a scene from a play and look at that with your learners and get use that as a way of getting into Shakespeare too. So really, there's a number of approaches you can take.
Yep, you've certainly given a lot there. Yes, it's true. And I'm glad you mentioned all those things because, you know, as you said, we're going to look at some of those in a moment. You mentioned something about the short British Council films. We'll have a look at those. And you mentioned something about modern English versions, so we'll definitely have a look at those. But the last thing you said there is also very interesting about, you know, lesson plans, because it's true. Even people like the Royal Shakespeare Company and the Globe Theatre, as well as lots of websites, as well as the British Council, and you know, lots of different people provide actual really great lesson plans, which, as you say, can be for different levels, different ages, and as you also said, like just focus on parts of the play rather than the whole play. And they can actually work for self-study as well, some of them. You know, if you look at some of these resources just and work through them on your own, not with a teacher, it can be great. I've put up on the screen here, I did this just exactly because, you know, you're not making this up as you go along just now. You've thought about this a lot. And you've actually written two very good blog posts that are available on the British Council Voices blog. And I just put them up here. Tina, who's reading all your comments, will share the links to these. And there are two that you can read, which is the first one is How to Make Shakespeare Easy for English Language Learners, which covers a lot of the points that Genny is just making there with some really good links to resources to practice. And the other one is a question some of you might be saying to yourself. We shouldn't teach Shakespeare to learners of English. It's a waste of time. It's not important for us. And this is Jenny's blog that says, wait a minute, that's not true, and gives the reasons why. So you can check these out. The links will be in the comments, and you'll find lots of interesting information there and lots of links to really good resources to help you. But let's go on from what you were saying a moment ago there. You mentioned some of this. Hold on, let me just get rid of Ben's question for a moment. Yeah, you mentioned some of this. So one thing, for example, is these British Council. We've done these short films, which are short animated films, which are basically telling the story of Shakespeare. And we use those on the course. I'll just play a little bit of this so you can see.
Hamlet, the Prince of Denmark.
Hamlet, the Prince of Denmark.
University to find that his father.
University to find that his father
is dead.
The old.
His mother has married his father's brother, Claudius, who is now King of Denmark. Hamlet is shocked that his mother has married so soon after his father's death, and angry that she has married Claudius.
Sorry about that at the start there. We had a little problem with the sound, muting. It's okay, Jenny. I'll unmute you. It's fine. There you go. You're done. So that was one. We've got a series of these that cover all of the plays that we look at in the course. And I'm just going to show you one other thing that I think is really good. I'll just mute us first. But these are the short films that were made by the British Council for the Shakespeare Lives anniversary a few years ago. And we made a whole series of these modern films. Some of them use Shakespeare text. Some of them use modern dialogue. Some of them use songs. They just look at the plays in a different way. And they're fantastic for teenagers, for adults, to kind of find something that's interesting. Some of them are really funny, for example. Some of them are quite scary. But I'll just play a little bit of one so you can see. And what's interesting about this one, if you watch, is that the dialogue is original Shakespeare, but the subtitles are in modern English. So as you read the subtitles, you can understand what they're saying much better. So I'll just play that.
We all stand up against the spirit of Caesar. And in the spirit of men, there is no blood. That we then could come by Caesar's spirit and not dismember Caesar. But alas, Caesar must bleed for it.
And we're back. So, Jenny, anything you'd like to say about those videos and how you can use them and so on?
Oh, I think these videos are amazing. There's such a good range of them. And as you said, Neil, there's, you know, so many different atmospheres from, you know, comical to scary. I think these could be used in a variety of ways. They could be used to really get into a key scene. So if you're wanting to just look at a particular scene, a great way to do it is to, whether you want to, you know, look at the scene first, look at the text first and talk about it and then show the clip, or you could show the film first and then look at the scene. Or it can also be used just as a way to generate interest, to show the film first of all and get learners speaking. You know, what do they think it's about? What do they think the themes might be? And then for that to lead on to maybe, you know, further study of the play as well. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, you could use them in all sorts of ways. Or even if you've got the time and you've got learners who might be interested in this kind of thing, show them a film like this. And then whatever play you're studying with Shakespeare, you could ask them if they could do their own short film. You know, nowadays mm-hmm. these projects are very easy to manage in class, as many, you know, most students have mobile phones. You can just make a short film with their phone and then share it back with the rest of the class.
I read a good lesson in that just today, actually, while I was preparing for this and looking at stuff like that, which was, you know, there's lots of modernized versions like that. Julius Caesar was obviously set in modern politics with soldiers and everything. And one way is kind of getting students to do that, to kind of take the play and then think, how would they modernize it? How would they set it? And, you know, what country would they set it in, or what time, or, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the great things about the course that we're speaking about, the Exploring English Shakespeare course, is that I think that's one of the questions we ask on one of the steps in the course. And so many learners come back and say, well, such and such a play, like Macbeth, for example, would work really well in my country. And they give, you know, they're able to compare, you know, that it was with something specific that's happening in their own country. So, you know, as well as
things, yeah.
Often, we often talk about, you know, Shakespeare's plays being very universal, and I think it's true, but also we can very specifically often link the plays and the themes in the plays to things that are happening in our own even local area. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, lots of comments coming in, so I'll just say, Kelly's just come back saying the dialogue amazed her so much in the Denzel Washington one. I would love to see it because it's got fantastic mm-hmm. actors in it. It's Denzel Washington and Frances McDormand as Lady Macbeth, and by one of the Coen brothers. Okay. Lots of people who have watched and read lots of plays, just going through them. Romeo and Juliet is definitely coming out as the most frequent one. George Martin Martinez, Romeo and Juliet, King Lear, and Merchant of Venice. Okay. Rama Saad liked Richard III's movie. Which one? I'm not sure. There may be more than one, but we'll see. Okay. And Amin saying Hamlet was my first play to read. That's a tough one to start with. Usually we start at school, Jenny, with, I mean, for me, I think the first one was either A Midsummer Night's Dream or Macbeth. I don't know. Can you remember?
Yeah, I can remember, all right. What I started with, we did The Merchant of Venice, which I don't actually...
The Merchant of Venice was the other one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't think it was a very good one to start with. I think Macbeth would be my choice if I was introducing Shakespeare to learners. I think it's a good one. Or maybe Romeo and Juliet.
Okay. So many people, there are lots of Shakespeare fans here. It's great to see lots of people saying that their favourite is King Lear and so on. Okay. Okay, and Claudia Diaz-Bergayo saying, I'm a teacher of literature. I give courses in Shakespeare's tragedies in Uruguay. Okay, maybe you'll find some good resources from the links we share today that you haven't seen before, and maybe you can share some resources with us in the comments. If you've got any websites or links that you think are really good for your students that you've used, that would be fantastic. Okay, let's move on to another question. Now, this is a good question from Wyminton. Which books about Shakespeare, saying are suitable for intermediate learners like me? Now, this is a good question because, you know, Shakespeare itself is really quite difficult, and obviously for higher level students quite often. Some of the stories we've shown from Shakespeare are great for different levels. You can do them at intermediate, maybe pre-intermediate. But books about Shakespeare, if you wanted to know more about the life of Shakespeare, I think our course is a really good place to start for that. What do you think?
That's what I was going to say. I mean, I can think of some books, you know, books about Shakespeare, but maybe not so useful for intermediate learners. Yeah. But I think our course is just such a good introduction. It's perfectly pitched for intermediate learners as well. And as well as finding out about Shakespeare's life, you'll find out, you know, all about his worldwide appeal, his contribution to the English language, all the words he invented, his themes, all sorts of things. So,
and what are some of the things about Shakespeare's life that we look at in the course? Some of the kind of interest, some of the highlights of the course, I guess, for looking at the...
People are always very intrigued by Shakespeare's lost years. Now, these were the years that Shakespeare just kind of, you know, seemed to disappear. There's not really any documentary evidence of what Shakespeare did during this period of time. And I think that's a really popular part of his history, even although, you know, it's actually... We don't know anything because learners on the course always really like to speculate about what he might have done during that period of time. And people are always very interested in his relationship with his wife as well, because he left his wife and children to go and be a playwright in London. And people are always very interested in asking questions about, did he love his wife? Of course, we don't know that. But they're also very interested in the fact that in Shakespeare's will, he left his second best bed to his wife. People find that funny. So and people are also very interested in the Globe Theatre. And yeah, I mean, there's so many things. It was such an interesting time to be alive in as well, because there was, you know, so much going on with Queen Elizabeth and then King James, and just very, very lively and quite turbulent time. So it's you find out all about that on week one of the course.
I was going to say, I guess we don't know who he left his best bed to then, do we?
No.
I've always known that fact that he left his second best bed and everything, but now I'm just wondering who got his best bed.
There's a very interesting podcast about this on now the Shakespeare Birthplace Trust, I think, and it talks about that. And actually, it turns out that it's not quite as much of an insult to his wife, as you might originally think. But I don't want to give much away. Listen to the podcast. It's very good.
Okay, we'll look out the link for that podcast and put it in. Okay, Aki's got a good point here. He's saying, when I read the play Macbeth, the language in the play is very difficult to understand, but it's really interesting. And of course, Kelly was saying earlier how much she enjoyed the film and so on. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is another thing you mentioned earlier, which is stuff like this, like modern translations. There's a few of these. I mean, you want to say something about those?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. So No Sweat, Shakespeare is probably, yeah, the most most well-known one. And I think it's great to be able to look at the original, you know, Shakespeare's English, and then compare it to the contemporary English as well. I mean, obviously, it's a very good way of finding out what happens in the play, finding out about the plot. Yeah. I would say, though, that a really big part of Shakespeare is the poetry of his original language. So, you know, it seems a shame to miss out on that altogether. So I think it really is what is really good about maybe, I mean, Macbeth, with the example of Macbeth, for example, it's a very action-packed play. So say you go to watch Macbeth on stage, or you watch a film adaptation of Macbeth where it's the original Shakespearean language, you're not going to understand every word, but you're going to have a very good idea of what's actually happening, because it's all very, 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 very visual. So I'd say, for me, I think a good approach is to, so the language doesn't get in the way, to watch a film or go and see a performance, and then you can use these, you know, translations like No Sweat Shakespeare. They're a great way of figuring out what some of the language means, but yeah, use them to help you, rather than for you just to read them completely and not do anything else.
I'd always agree with that, and it's certainly true. It was true for me as well. I mean, you know, when we had to read Shakespeare at school, it wasn't always presented in the most exciting or interesting way. When you go to see a play, yeah, as you say, you don't need to understand everything. That's, you know, all the dialogue. It's very clear from what you can understand. You follow the action, you know what's happening, you get wrapped up in the whole events and everything that's going on there, and it's a completely different experience. And of course, Shakespeare wrote for the stage. He didn't write for the page, you know, in that. And it's always a good idea, I think. I mean, like Kelly was mentioning earlier about the Macbeth film and stuff like that, I think it's always a good idea, if you can, to watch first before you read. But then, as you say, these translations can help, you know, with the stuff like that. I mean, because if you look at this, it's just, you know, one of the most famous lines from Shakespeare, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name. You can see that there could be a lot of problems there for someone learning English, for whom English is a second language. Wherefore is a word that doesn't exist anymore in English, you know, thy father, thy name, all that. So, you know, they simplify it to just, Romeo, Romeo, why are you Romeo? Which is, you know, which I wish you could stop being a Montague. That's all it means. And like you say, it doesn't have the poetry.
It is.
But, you know, it makes the meaning easy to follow. So we'll put a link for those in as well. Okay. I'm just scrolling through the comments now. I'm going to have to sneeze in a second. So I'm going to put this up one up very quickly.
To get some warning.
I'm sorry, I'm not very well today, so I'm holding everything in at the moment, because no one wants to watch me coughing and sneezing for 5 minutes, but it will all come out at some point. So hello, Monica from Chile. I've watched 4 different films with Hamlet. That's guessing that you must like Hamlet then, to have watched 4 different versions. I think, how many have you watched? Can you think? I can think of a few. The Laurence Olivier one, I've watched that. The one with Andrew Scott, a recent one, I watched that, and one with David Tennant, I watched that.
I think
one.
I've just seen the two, actually.
Okay. There's a lot of ones that are really worth looking out there, and from other different countries as well. Okay. Okay. Alina's a big fan, saying, I've seen and read all the plays written by William Shakespeare. He is and will remain my favorite. I'm absolutely fascinated by everything he's written. My favorites are the sonnets. We haven't actually mentioned the sonnets yet. You want to say a little bit about the sonnets as well? For a moment, and for people who don't know what they are, for a start, perhaps.
Well, the sonnets are a collection of poems written by William Shakespeare, and they're very beautiful. Many of them are addressed to, to this mysterious woman. And that's something else that people love to speculate about. But yeah, they're definitely the sonnets, although they're not mentioned in the course, they're definitely worth a look. I'm not sure if we have any resources on the sonnets, actually, now that I come to think of it. Neil, do we?
On the course, but we can certainly share some here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Riaz Lagari is saying, teaching Shakespeare is not child's play. That's absolutely true, when both the teacher and students are non-native speakers. The language Shakespeare uses poses a formidable challenge for both the teacher and the learners. Absolutely true. But I think the resources and some of the things we've shared here today and our course, Exploring English Shakespeare, can really help with all of that. It's okay. Sorry, just one moment. Ose Babeki, having read Shakespeare as deeply as possible, Macbeth has to be the most emotionally striking of all his plays. Hello from Congo. Okay, a few more comments coming in. And this is one, I remember this was similar to my experience, and I remember this from your blog post as well, Jenny Kelly, saying, I was introduced to Shakespeare when I was 10 years old at school, and it was a disaster. But now I could watch and read his plays all day long. So Kelly's great. That's a role model there for what you were talking about. It's about how important it is when you start Shakespeare to have a good introduction, but then how you can, you can come back to it and change it. Say a little bit about that, please, Jenny, about the kind of...
Yeah, I think as we touched upon earlier, I think that many people have had these, less than ideal introductions to Shakespeare. And it often happens because maybe the teacher isn't very enthusiastic, or maybe they aren't even that familiar with Shakespeare, and they just think the way to approach Shakespeare is just like sitting and reading the play from beginning to end. And I think anyone who's ever been in that situation will tell you that it really doesn't work. I mean, in my class, I think we had to take it in turns to go around the class reading the play aloud, and nobody even knew how to say the words, and occasionally like there'd be a lot of laughter, because not for the right reasons, but because somebody would pronounce something strangely and it would sound a little bit rude or something like that. So it was just it was memorable for all the wrong reasons. But I think that part of it is as well, when you grow up and you grow older and you maybe come back to Shakespeare on your own terms, you choose the plays that speak to you. So for example, it was years before I looked at The Merchant of Venice again, but I found that some of the tragedies like Macbeth, King Lear in particular, Othello, just resonated a lot more with me personally. Looking at the plays that interested me was a big factor. And as I said earlier, I've seen time and time again on the course, people who've worked their way through the course, may have had a bad introduction to Shakespeare, but by the end of it, they're saying, they feel so enthused for the future and just want to continue.
Ready to try again.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. A nice suggestion here from Fiorella Toma, who's saying, after studying the tragedy and analysing characters, I gave my students this activity. I asked them to imagine being Romeo or Juliet and to write a daily blog expressing their feelings and mood. What do you think about that? I think that's a lovely idea. What do you think, Jenny?
I think it's excellent. And I love it when teachers, they adapt Shakespeare to suit the interests of their learners. I think recently I came across a teacher who had this great idea, and he devised this lesson using, what was it? It was called Beat or Barge. And he was reading out some hip hop or something, I think. I'm not very good with modern day music, but he was reading out some hip hop, and some of it was like real like hip hop music, and some of it was Shakespeare. And he was saying the students had to guess whether it was Shakespeare or it was some other like rapper. I'm not quite sure how it worked, but I mean, he said it was a huge success and his students loved it, which is the main thing.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Patrizia Petricelli is just saying something nice, just saying, I use a lot of your resources in class. They're amazing. Thank you. That's always lovely to hear. Okay. Bear with me for just a second. Okay. And now this is a good question again from Aki. I'm not going to limit it to Macbeth, but Aki saying, what will be the benefits from understanding the language used in the play? I actually have another little video clip. We need to finish soon, but I'll skip the video clip. I'll let you answer instead. You know, there are advantages in actually learning and understanding the language of Shakespeare and so on.
Actually Shakespeare's language has much more in common with contemporary English than we might initially think. Now, I think the video Neil was going to show contained a very interesting statistic, which I can never remember statistics, but Neil will remember. And
it's the interesting fact. People think of Shakespeare as being so far from our language, but only 5% of the words used in Shakespeare are no longer in modern use, in common use. You know, 95% of the words he used, we still use today. Some of them may have changed the meaning a little, but really there's only 5%. Like, you know, even an example earlier was wherefore, as an example. That doesn't exist in English anymore. It's an old way to say why. That's gone. But words like that only represent 5% of all the words used in Shakespeare, and the other 95% we still use today.
As well as you know, there being, you know, so many of the words we still use, there are so many expressions that Shakespeare coined which we still use today in English, and you'll come across these when reading the plays, and you'll think, oh. You know, or this is may even so many of the expressions not only are used in English, but may well be translated into your own language. So, you know, we've got expressions like, you know, to be a night owl, if you like to, you know, if you do your best work at night, or if things happen at snail's pace, they happen very slowly. These are all expressions that Shakespeare coined. So, you know, as well as you're going to learn all these expressions, you know, you're going to develop your ability to read, your fluency in reading is going to develop a lot as well, I think. And then if you're learning Shakespeare on the course, you're also going to have the chance to talk about what you've learned with, you know, other learners on the course. So that's going to develop your fluency in expressing your thoughts and ideas as well. So there's a lot of benefits learning Shakespeare.
Okay, we're going to have to finish just shortly, but there's another nice suggestion from Claudia here, which is saying, I suggest Shakespeare's biography by Bill Bryson, a nice, easy and interesting book to be read by non-native English speakers. So we had the question earlier about a book to read about Shakespeare. Maybe that's one to look out, that biography, and try, give it a try. Okay, just... from Badgie saying, I read Shakespeare's plays in Burmese language, now I'm trying to read in English. Which play is the most suitable for me? Now I'm elementary level, thanks a million. I would say at elementary level, it's maybe not the best idea to try to read a whole play. I don't know, what would you say?
Yeah, I would agree with Neil. I think, there's nothing to stop you trying, but I would suggest maybe going on to, you know, one of the videos, like one of the videos Neil showed earlier, on the British Council site, looking at some of the short films might be helpful, and then maybe working through some of the activities and building up that way. I think at elementary level, you're probably not ready to start like sitting down and reading a play just yet.
Okay. Claudia's also shared an update on the second best bed thing, but I can't share it just now. Okay, I think there's lots of interesting comments coming in. Hold on. Okay, I like this one. I do like this one. There's so many comments I'm having trouble getting to. Right. I'm there now. From Belal Nabil Elberi, who read an article written by an Egyptian professor claiming that Shakespeare's work was in fact oriented to common people, not to highly educated people specifically. Now he goes on to say that for that reason, it doesn't contain the philosophical meaning some critics explained while analyzing his work. Two things there I think they're interesting. The first part I would agree with absolutely. Shakespeare, I mean, who were the people that went to see Shakespeare?
Try again.
Who were the people who went to see Shakespeare's plays?
Everybody went to see Shakespeare's plays. So they were.
Either. It's not just me. From,
nobility,
yes. Not an easy one. I mean, it cost a penny or something. It cost, you know, nothing to go and see. So, I mean, all the people that were going and watching Shakespeare's plays live at the Globe were absolutely, you know, anyone from any walk of life. Now, the point that this is the interesting point, the second part that this professor claims is that Shakespeare didn't actually intend all these deeper meanings. I would disagree with that, in my opinion. Anna, what
I would disagree
you say,
too. I think the beauty of Shakespeare's work is you can just approach it at any level. So you can, they're wonderful stories with really memorable characters, but I don't think you can read or watch any of his plays, especially, you know, the problem plays or the tragedies, without being really struck by what Shakespeare has to say about, you know, the human condition. It's incredible the insight he has into it. So yeah, I think it's definitely, these are works on many levels.
Mm-hmm. Okay, last comment, just because it's a good one to finish with, I think, from Claudia Pacheco, which is, Shakespeare is always actual. Each story has a lot of relationships that we can compare with ours today. I think that's as good a way to finish as any. Any final message for people before we go, Jenny?
I think my message would be, if you haven't already joined the course and if you've been interested in what we've been talking about today, then please do join, because I don't think you'd regret it.
Okay. And thank you all for watching. I'm sorry that we couldn't be here longer and share more, but we have shared a lot of resources in the comments, and we'll go back and have a look at your questions. And if there's any questions that you've got that you've asked, we'll try and help more and share more later. As Jenny said, check out our free course. It's free, so why not? But it's really good. It's a really interesting experience. And I think everyone that we've had any feedback from has really enjoyed it. So it's definitely worth having a look at. And for any level, I would say, from pre-intermediate up to advanced, it would be good. Okay, so thank you, Jenny. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. I'm going to say goodbye now, and we'll see you again the next time we have one of these. Okay, so
goodbye.
Bye for now.